So I'm here in my think tank, if you're wondering why this looks like a car. It actually is. Just one sentence about myself. So I'm data scientist in the IBM Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies. And today I want to introduce you to some concepts for privacy or privacy preserving machine learning. And I will go over federated learning, differential privacy, homomorphic encryption, and trusted execution environments. So let's actually start the show. And I have prepared two labs for you as well, that you can get your hands dirty a bit. So state of the art, as you might have already wondered, is the following. So you have your device in place, and you are constantly sending all your private data to somewhere, and you don't even know to where, usually. And there are some concerns about that. So you see here, we are having a big tube of data going from your device to somewhere in the cloud. And what you then get in return is AI or machine learning model, which is trained for your purposes, and you can basically make use of that model. So it doesn't matter whether the model here sits in the cloud or gets transferred to your device, that doesn't fix the problem, okay? So there are a couple of solutions emerging to this problem. So the problem one is data privacy, and this is obvious, but the second is maybe not so obvious. But if you send all your data, or let's say if the humanity sends all data to only a couple of large players, then information cartels emerge. And we first saw this in, in the advertisement industry. So this is already a problem which affects the economy. But now we saw also recently, a couple of years ago, that this affects our society and democracy. So this is even a larger problem. So this needs to be fixed soon, okay? So there are a couple of solutions emerging, as I already said. So one of that is a homomorphic encryption. So homomorphic encryption is pretty cool because it allows you to compute on the encrypted data. So you see here the user is sending his data to the cloud as well. But before he sends the data to the cloud, he applies the full homomorphic encryption function. And that's only a placeholder. There are different algorithms with different advantages and disadvantages. So that's just a placeholder function, okay? Full homomorphic encryption. And the data goes then to the cloud in an encrypted fashion. So it never leaves the device without encryption. And then the cool thing is that you can process the data while it is encrypted. So you can apply the same computations on those, and then you can return the result, or you can train a machine learning model, and even you can query the machine learning model on encrypted data. So this is too nice to be true, because although it works, there is one limitation. Oh, there are two limitations. The main limitation is the overhead, which was many orders of magnitude. And the second is most of those introduce some noise into the data. And that's also for, let's say, moving money from one account to another. This could be problematic, as you can imagine. But recently we published a paper and also released all the code as open source, where the overhead was mitigated. So it's now less than one order of magnitude of overhead. It's still a lot, but it's something you can cope with. And the second is we mitigated also the problem of the noise. So if you see here, the area under ROC curve, the plain text and the homomorphic encrypted performance of the algorithm is rather the same. So that's pretty cool. So that you don't get bored, I will now directly jump into a lab. And yeah, by the way, this is the code. You can have a look at the code. It's open source. And now let's have the first lab. So the first lab is basically showing you a algorithm in Python, which you then can execute and work with. If you have a Jupyter environment handy, just use that. If you don't, we have a free and easy one to use for you. You just go to labs.cognitiveclass.ai. And once you're there, you can sign up either with your email and password, or you can just use SSO with LinkedIn, Google, GitHub, or Facebook. So you should be up and running within 2 minutes. And then when you are logged in, you should see the view on the bottom right, and you can just click on Jupyter Lab, and then you have an ordinary Jupyter Lab environment ready for you, okay? And then just import this on the link above, the HE_1 notebook, and then you can walk through it. So I have put in 2 tasks and just solved the task. It's very simple. And just please use the question and answer function, and I will answer the questions either directly to you via text, or if it is affecting everybody, then I will also do it on the audio and video channel. So I'm seeing already 1 question. Can you post the link in the chat? Ah, yeah, that's a very good idea.
So I just share the link to cognitiveclass.ai in the chat.
Okay, so let's share both. So another question. In the meantime, can you elaborate on the issue of information cartels? What is it, and what were the economic effects you were referring to? Okay, so yeah, see, I'm just using one company as example, and I have nothing against the company, but it has a lot of, let's say, influence and tooling. So it's a very good example. So let's take Google and YouTube. So if you go to YouTube, based on your profile and all the information Google gathered about you, you are getting a list of recommended videos. And that's definitely something which I'm not saying that YouTube is doing it, but which is critical, because then some small entity decides on what type of videos a huge population of people are watching. And that's one thing. And the second is those algorithms are, and that holds also for Facebook and all social media, they are maximizing screen time. So the most critical resource on a user base is the screen time. And they don't care whether you are feeling well or not. It's just about the screen time. And let me just finish 1 sentence about that, about the personal example. So I was 2 years ago or 3 years ago exploring around cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin, and all was perfectly fine. And then YouTube recommended some financial videos to me, and then I had watched those, and then YouTube recommended some conspiracy theory videos to me, and then from a pure technical search, I was watching videos about conspiracy theories. So that's definitely something I don't want in my brain. And another thing, just Google for Palantir, P-A-L-A-N-T-I-R. And the rest you will find out yourself. Okay, so next question. If you train models on encrypted data in which it learns relations, can't the information cartels extract those information they need from it anyway? Okay, so I will dive into that later, because this is a problem, and that's that can also be mitigated. So I will mark this as answered. Or let's have it there, because it's not answered. I just said I will answer it later. This is a reminder for me. And another thing, while you are doing the lab, so once you are finished, just put one finished. So the first one, just can put one finished in the QA section, and then you can upvote. Whenever you are finished, just upvote for that question. And maybe you can also put one not finished and then upvote on that, that I get an idea how many have finished and how many not. Okay, and I have another question. It says not really a question, but I'm struggling to understand how IBM is also not an information cutter given it's up there with Amazon, Microsoft offering all these cloud solutions. Yeah, okay, there's a little difference because I'm not really speaking about Amazon Web Services and Microsoft Azure Cloud. I'm more speaking about social media cartels. That's one thing. And another thing is, yes, it's true. IBM has the same problem, and we are mitigating the problem with technology I'm currently presenting. So I'm not saying trust IBM because we are more trustworthy. It's more about have a look at what the technology is bringing that you don't even need to trust anybody. Okay, so that's privacy and security by design. I hope this is answering your question. If not, you can just type another one. Ah, okay. So how to open the notebook inside labs.cognitiveclass.ai. So what you need to do is you say, click on Jupyter Lab. Ah, maybe I can just share it. Okay. So you go, do I have it still open? Yes. So when you start, you see that after you have logged in, and then you click on Jupyter Lab. And what now happens is in the background, Kubernetes pod gets started, and then Jupyter Lab gets started inside, and all the output is streamed to this frame here. Okay, so now you can here upload a Jupyter notebook. And the question maybe is, how do you download it? So you go to this repository, and then you select the notebook. And then what you can do is you say here on raw, and on the right mouse button, you say save link as. And you see here, you can download then the Jupyter notebook to your local file system. And then, of course, you can here upload it again. Okay, so please let me know if this answers your question. Okay, do you have a requirements list for PIP for people who don't have Conda? Let me double check if there are any requirements at all. So I don't have the list written, but let me double check. So you need, actually for that one, you don't need anything. I think it's pure Python. That's the cool thing here. It's not taking any libraries into consideration. It's just, so import random, import sys, those are all default libraries. They are all available. And for the other lab, I think you need only NumPy. And later on, I'm installing TensorFlow Federated using a pip command for you in the notebook. So this should already be solved. So the decryption step is encrypted bits, modulo P, modulo 2. Does the security depend on modulo not being reversible? Wouldn't it be relatively cheap to try different values of P until you get something? I also don't have too much crypto knowledge. So this is more on get the feeling that it actually works. Okay, so that you see that you can, for example, add two integers on the cipher and then decrypt it and you get the result. It's definitely not something you want to use in production. It's obviously more complicated than that. Therefore, exist a lot of libraries. But this is, I have provided a link here. This is a very cool guy, Bill Buchan. And here's the link where I got the code from. And it's the Hello World example. So if you are interested, you can dive into it if you open this link here. And there are many different algorithms explained. And then will you be explaining what's in the notebook, or do we just go over the material? Yeah, you should go over by yourself, and I will explain if the majority of the attendees tells me that they are finished, or they are getting bored and want to see my 2 cents on it. When running the index notebook, I'm getting... index notebook you shouldn't run. You should run the HE_1. HE for homomorphic encryption, and 1 is lab 1. So this is, by the way, the first time I'm teaching this lab. Therefore, there's only 1 lab available. So when running the index... that's Sebastian, now I read the whole question. So you're saying that you have the wrong NumPy version for TensorFlow Federated. Yeah, I assume you're not running inside cognitiveclass.ai. You're running in your own environment. So what you can do is you say pip install upgrade NumPy, and then you have both the latest version of NumPy and TensorFlow Federated. That should work. But you are anyway on the wrong notebook. We will have a look at that later. Okay, so may I ask the question, who of you has already finished or wants to have a discussion about a solution? You can use the latest versions of everything, and that should work fine. So at least I'm doing it always like that. Unless it's crashing, then I'm rolling back the versions. Okay, so Jakobus said he's finished, so you can upvote on Jakobus' question, that we get an idea of how many are finished or fed up. And I'm not seeing the upvotes, so if someone from the moderators can just tell me.
We're at about 10 upvotes now, so they're coming in gradually.
Okay. So I have 1 more hour left, is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Yeah, maybe then we will just have a look at the notebook now. Okay, so the first is the simple 1-bit homomorphic cipher. This is, of course, a bit boring because you can either set message to 1 or 0 and then afterwards you get either 1 or 0 back. Okay, that's, let's say, the very basic hello world. But then it's getting more interesting. You have the 2-bit adder, and you see here. So it means you can add 2 bits with 2 bits. That means you have already a value range of 4 for each one. So the maximum you should get is 8 and the minimum 0. So that means you can compute already values between 0 and 8. So if you set here everything to 1, you have a 4 here and a 4 here. And then you can just play around. And you should then see if you have a 1 and a 1 and a 1 and a 1 here, then you should see 1, 1, 1, 1. That's basically 7. Okay. That's about it. The interesting thing here is that all those values are now encrypted, and you see that the computation is done on the encrypted data. Okay, that's some sort of proof that it somehow works. Don't worry if you don't understand the code, me neither. So if you are interested, just have a look at this site here, which really explains it from bottom up. So let's continue. So the next thing we can do is federated learning. The idea here is that the data is kept on the edge devices. So for example, your mobile phone. and the training happens on the device. You see here the CPU and the data symbol is on the device, and only the model is in the cloud. So let's consider you have three devices and you want to compute the average or the mean of all the data stored. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And let's go into presentation mode. So what you can do is you can compute the mean on each device, and then you can compute the mean on each device's mean, and you get the same result. So let's test it. So it's 1 plus 2 is 3, plus 3 is 6, plus 4 is 10, plus 5 is 15, plus 6 is 21. If we now compute the mean, we have to divide by 6, and that's basically 3.5. So 6 times 3 is 18, and 6 times 0.5 is 3, and 18 plus 3 is 21. Okay. So as you see here, the intermediate aggregates are sent to the cloud. So this might be a problem. So you can switch to a ring topology where you send your intermediate aggregate only to the neighbor, and the neighbor performs a computation, and that actually gives you the same result, but doesn't disclose the aggregates to the cloud. This also works for deep learning training, not only for computing averages. So you see here the so-called Chef Dean style data parallelism, where you have the same model on different servers or nodes, and you show only partitions of the data, only a subset of the data to each model. And every now and then, you synchronize the trained weights to a central parameter server, and only the weights are shared. And then the weights are averaged and sent back to the model, and that's how parallel training works. So this is some sort of a proof that training neural networks on multiple nodes in parallel is working. Okay? And this also holds for the federated model. We can use a library here, TensorFlow Federated. There are also others. And that actually allows to run server-side code only while you implement the stuff. And TensorFlow Federated takes care on the data management and the computation, distribution of computation. So this is bringing us to the next lab. So you can use all the same links, just use FL_1. Okay, here I have another question. Can you talk about when taking the median of medians is a good approximation and when it might not be? Yeah, actually, the thing is that example I just had there to show you an example where the federated computation doesn't work, because actually, if you can use the median as a good approximation, then you rather can also use the mean. And when you can't use the median as a good approximation, then you need actually have the real value. So the computing the median in a federated fashion is non-trivial. There are implementations, but they are flawed in my opinion. So you can always try to reconstruct original data. What is your opinion on privacy attacks on federated learning models? I've read about model poisoning from malicious clients that could open backdoors. I haven't heard about that. What I will talk about later is that the models itself can be used to reconstruct data. And this is something differential privacy plays a role. But that's something which I definitely need to check out. Thanks a lot. So I don't know it, but it's another thing I have to check out. That's a bit in the category of adversarial robustness, because you can also create data which leads for misbehavior of the model. And here it seems you can create data which leads the model to be parameterized in a way that you then later on can use the model to generate original data. So the model anyway has this flaw that you can generate original data from the model, but if you can improve this attack by poisoning it with malicious data, that's even more severe. So I have another question. Are there federated learning equivalents for common supervised learning algorithms, both classification and regression? Yes, there are. So the cool thing is everything which you can train with gradient descent, you can run in a federated fashion, because gradient descent just updates weights. And the weight updates, as you have seen before, can be federated. That means you train on a local data set, and that weights you send somewhere, and those get incorporated usually by averaging or by weighted averaging, and that contributes to the model. And by the way, that's how you would poison the model, because you can have special data which gives you special weights, and that weights are incorporated in the overall model and then later be used. So I'm really curious to read about it, and next session definitely I will also introduce the poisoning attack. Okay, so let's go to the top. So as you can see here, I'm using a seed that we can compare the results, and I'm generating 10 random values. So let's actually do this. And then I have here array shape 10.3, so 3 times 10 values. And also I have here the flattened data. And you see here that's already the mean for the flattened data, okay? Because you have here the sum of all the elements and then the length of all the elements, and that's defined as the mean. So if you want to do this federated, it's basically the same. So we can say we take the sum of one data partition and the length of a data partition. So that's the federated mean that can run on now each mobile device, for example. And then we just map over the results. So we say, remember how I did this? So I map over our client data. So map. How is it? First the function, so it's federated mean. The second is the data. Then in theory, you should get none, okay. We should return, of course, the value. So and now we just do the same computation here. So we sum, and then I just divide by 3. You should compute the length. So we get here nearly the same value. Okay, that's rounding errors. That's okay. So then the federated median. So we have here the same data. For sake of time, I'll just check out the master solution. I have put the master solution here because it involves a lot of if-else typing. So I'll just copy-paste it. So, and I'll just walk you through quickly. Okay, So the data partition comes in, then this is independent whether you are computing the median on a partition or on the whole data. You sort the data and you just take the middle value basically. The problem is the middle value is different whether you have an odd or even number of elements. So if you have an odd number of elements, it's pretty simple and straightforward. You take the number of elements minus 1 divided by 2, then you are right in the middle and you can access the index. That's the median. In case of an even size, then you need to do a trick. You have to take the two middle elements and then average on the two middle elements. So the index, the first index is n over 2 minus 1 and the next is n over 2. So those are the two middle elements. And then you just address those here. You add those up and divide by 2, then you get the median. Okay, this should work. And so you can, as I said, use the same function for the complete data set. Then you see you get 0.4. And now you can do the same trick. You can map over. Well, you can map over the list and then take the median of the intermediate results. Let's actually do this step by step. So first we map over the list of the federated partitions. And you see here you get three different medians. And if we now take the median of this list here, you get a number which is different from the other one, okay? And it depends on the distribution of the data, how different this is. So in other words, median is not something you can easily compute in a federated environment. And now you can just install TensorFlow Federated. And if you are running outside Google Colab, you need to install Nest Async.io. And also you need to execute this Nest Async.io.apply. I haven't understood why, to be honest. I just saw the solution on Stack Overflow. But now the notebook is portable. That's pretty cool. And while this is running, basically here I'm importing TensorFlow. I'm calling this Nest Async.io apply. And now I can annotate a function as a federated computation. And also the signature I have to define so that this data set is marked to reside on the client. And then I can compute a federated mean. And maybe we can go back to it later. It takes some time to get installed. And let's continue with the last slides. So differential privacy, you have, as you already saw, the idea of share aggregates only in federated learning, or you share weights only. But the problem is the reconstruction attack. So if you share aggregates only, then you have the problem of the reconstruction attack. You can read that in that Wikipedia article. And in case you are sharing weights, then you can use the model to generate data. So each model can be basically turned around and used to generate data. So for example, one data leakage problem is if you have sales by country and sales by line of business and the total sales, if you have one entity in the data set which has only one occurrence for a specific line of business and county ID, then you obviously can compute the value of the sales. That's just the easy example. There are other forms of estimating data about individuals. And the conclusion is then no privacy without noise. So you have to introduce noise. That's called epsilon differential privacy. So epsilon stands for error. So you have to introduce noise, and you can calibrate the noise to the sensitivity in private data analysis. And that, in other words, means the more individuals are involved in an aggregate, the less noise you need to be added, because the harder it gets to guess values about individuals. And the last thing, which might be the most production-ready solution we have today, is using trusted execution environments. And the latest kit on the block is Software Guard Extensions from Intel SGX, which is not so late on the block because it's from 2015. The idea is that you have the possibility to execute a process, and the process has private memory, and the memory is encrypted, and nobody can read it. Neither the operating system, nor the hypervisor, nor a parallel process, nor a process running on the same operating system with root privileges, and also not if you have access to the physical hardware. So we have now implemented a solution on that with our partner Fortinix. There you have a complete end-to-end data shield. So data in transit, it's easy. You use SSL, and data addressed, it's also easy. You can use AES 256 or something. But at runtime, while data is in the main memory, you can now also encrypt it using that extension. And I haven't dived too much into it to really tell you how the key management is done. So that's also on my list to find out how the key management is done. So there is a HSM on those machines, so hardware security module, which can keep a private key. And so what I've read so far in the specification, it's only secure if you use AES 128, which is a hardware implementation. Otherwise, you can guess the keys using side channels. So for those who don't know what side channels are a text which gives you some clues about the key. For example, by having a look at the power consumption, you because, for example, in RSA, you use the square and multiply algorithm, and squaring and multiplication uses a different amount of energy and takes a different amount of time on the CPU. And that way you can, in the energy consumption, see the patterns of a square and multiply algorithm, and then infer the private key. So having said this, it's still a valid scenario where you, for example, use the private key, which is stored in the HSM of the machine, and using the public key of that corresponding private key, you encrypt the data before sending it to the cloud. And then the GSX, SGX environment can basically then pull out the private key from the HSM, or use the HSM for encrypting decrypting the data. Okay, so somehow this solves the data privacy problem, and also the information cartel problem. So there are solutions. They are not all 100% mature, but I think within the next couple of years, they will become de facto standard. And now it's time for answering questions and starting discussions. So there's no question now, as of now. So please feel free to ask questions.
Yes, thank you, Romeo, for giving this insight in data privacy. There was one question remaining from Dennis Buckhuis, which I asked in the beginning.
Yeah.
It's if you train on models on encrypted data in which it learns relations, can't the information cartels extract the information they need from it anyway?
Yeah, that's a good question. I guess as of now, yes, with an exception to... with a slight exception to homomorphic encryption, because in homomorphic encryption, also the data which is being transferred to the model is encrypted. So if you want to prevent this from happening, then the schema should be private as well. because you can, if you know what, how the schema looks like of the model, then you can, of course, artificially create data and query the model. So this is still an unsolved problem. I would say the answer to your question is yes. With the current technology we have, we can extract that information. But I see the most promising mitigation to that problem in the area of homomorphic encryption.
Did you answer the question on privacy attacks on federated learning models already? Might have missed
it. Yeah, I answered that question. I just left it open because I wanted to keep it as a reminder for myself because that's something I need to check out. So I didn't have the answer to that question. So formally, it's not answered.
Okay. There's another question from
the I have one at least. So that's the Google keyboard. They are using TensorFlow Federated. Unfortunately, the source code is closed, so we have to trust that what you type is not being sent to Google. It would be nice if that would have been open source, but still, it's an interesting claim that Google tells us that it is using TensorFlow Federated, which is a bit hard to believe. Because I have heard from a student who did working for us and doing her master thesis on TensorFlow Federated. And she was saying that the whole TensorFlow Federated code is still very early stage and not really working on distributed devices. But maybe the code in the Google keyboard is something they use internally and they are just in the stage of releasing the code for the public, and that's also an explanation. But we trust Google. I mean, they are more secure than maybe a Swiss bank. They have great engineers, so I think from outside nobody's will steal the data. No? Maybe only from inside.
Okay, then if those were all the questions, I would like to thank you, Romeo, for sharing this insight. And we hope to hear more from you or your colleagues soon at maybe some future PyData events. Before we finish up, I'm just going to quickly go over the schedule again. We're ending a little bit early today, but if there are any further questions, then people are welcome to join the Discord. We have a specific channel for the for this workshop, and there's also a voice channel if you want to speak in person. We do have some colleagues from Romeo in the Discord to help out or to answer any further questions. Then on 12:30 European time, we'll start with the sprint preparation on project layouts and how to understand them. There's a panel session on building inclusive, accessible data community right after that. And tonight we have two talks by Max Gendler and Thomas Vostok. All right, then I think that's it for now. Once again, thank you, Romeo. And I hope you'll join us in the Discord to answer any further questions. So.
Yes, I'm there and waiting for your questions. Thanks a lot. All the best.
All right. Thank you. Have a nice day.